Books on Tape presents Super Crunchers, Why Thinking by Numbers is the New Way to Be Smart, by Ian Ayres. Narrated by Michael Kramer. Introduction. The Rise of the Super Crunchers. Orly Ashenfelter really loves wine. When a good red wine ages, he says, something quite magical happens. Yet Orly isn't just obsessed with how wine tastes. He wants to know about the forces behind great and not-so-great wines. When you buy a good red wine, he says, you're always making an investment, in the sense that it's probably going to be better later. And what you'd like to know is, not what it's worth now, but what it's going to be worth in the future. Even if you're not going to sell it, even if you're going to drink it. If you want to know, how much pleasure am I going to get by delaying my gratification? That's an endlessly fascinating topic. It's a topic that has consumed a fair amount of his life for the last 25 years. In his day job, Orly crunches numbers. He uses statistics to extract hidden information from large data sets. As an economist at Princeton, he's looked at the wages of identical twins to estimate the impact of an extra year of school. He's estimated how much states value a statistical life by looking at differences in speed limits. For years, he edited the leading economics journal in the United States, the American Economic Review. Ashenfelter is a tall man with a bushy mane of white hair and a booming, friendly voice that tends to dominate a room. No milquetoast he. He's the kind of guy who would quickly disabuse you of any stereotype you might have that number crunchers are meek, retiring souls. I've seen Orly stride around a classroom, gutting the reasoning behind a seminar paper with affable exuberance. When he starts out his remarks with over-the-top praise, watch out. What's really gotten Orly in trouble is crunching numbers to assess the quality of Bordeaux wines. Instead of using the swishing and spitting approach of wine gurus like Robert Parker, Orly has used statistics to find out what characteristics of vintage are associated with higher or lower auction prices. It's really a no-brainer, he said. Wine is an agricultural product dramatically affected by the weather from year to year. Using decades of weather data from France's Bordeaux region, Orly found that low levels of harvest rain and high average summer temperatures produce the greatest wines. The statistical fit on data from 1952 through 1980 was remarkably tight for the red wines of Burgundy as well as Bordeaux. Bordeaux are best when the grapes are ripe and their juice is concentrated. In years when the summer is particularly hot, grapes get ripe, which lowers their acidity. And in years when there is below average rainfall, the fruit gets concentrated. So it's in the hot and dry years that you tend to get the legendary vintages. Ripe grapes make supple, low-acid wines. Concentrated grapes make full-bodied wines. He's had the temerity to reduce his theory to a formula. Wine quality equals 12.145 plus 0.00117 winter rainfall plus 0.0614 average growing season temperature, minus 0.00386 harvest rainfall. That's right. By plugging the weather statistics for any year into this equation, Ashenfelter can predict the general quality of any vintage. With a slightly fancier equation, he can make more precise predictions for the vintage quality at more than 100 chateaus. It may seem a bit mathematical, he acknowledges, but this is exactly the way the French ranked their vineyards back in the famous 1855 classifications. Traditional wine critics have not embraced Ashenfelter's data-driven predictions. Britain's Wine magazine said, "The formula's self-evident silliness invites disrespect." William Suckelin, a New York wine merchant, said the Bordeaux wine industry's view of Ashenfelter's work ranges somewhere between violent and hysterical. At times, he's been scorned by trade members. When Ashenfelter gave a wine presentation at Christie's wine department, dealers in the back openly hissed at his presentation. Maybe the world's most influential wine writer and publisher of The Wine Advocate, Robert Parker, colorfully called Ashenfelter an absolute total sham. Even though Ashenfelter is one of the most respected quantitative economists in the world, to Parker his approach is really a Neanderthal way of looking at wine. It's so absurd as to be laughable. Parker dismisses the possibility that a mathematical equation could help identify wines that actually taste good. I'd hate to be invited to his house to drink wine. Parker says Ashenfelter is rather like a movie critic who never goes to see the movie but tells you how good it is based on the actors and the director. Parker has a point. Just as it's more accurate to see the movie, shouldn't it be more accurate to actually taste the wine? There's just one catch. For months and months, there is no wine to taste. Bordeaux and Burgundies spend 18 to 24 months in oak casks before they are set aside for aging in bottles. Experts like Parker have to wait 4 months just to have a first taste after the wine is placed in barrels. And even then, it's a rather foul fermenting mixture. It's not clear that tasting this undrinkable early wine gives tasters very accurate information about the wine's future quality. For example, Bruce Kaiser, former director of the wine department at Auctioneer Butterfield & Butterfield, has claimed, "Young wines are changing so quickly that no one, and I mean no one, can really evaluate a vintage at all accurately by taste until it is at least 10 years old, perhaps older." In sharp contrast, Orly crunches numbers to find the historical relationship between weather and price. That's how he found out that each centimeter of winter rain tends to raise the expected price $0.00117. Of course, it's only a tendency, but number crunching lets Orly predict the future quality of a vintage as soon as the grapes are harvested, months before even the first barrel taste, and years before the wine is sold. In a world where wine futures are actively traded, Ashenfelter's predictions gave wine collectors a huge leg up on the competition. Ashenfelter started publishing his predictions in the late 80s in a semi-annual newsletter called Liquid Assets. He advertised the newsletter at first with small ads in Wine Spectator and slowly built a base of about 600 subscribers. The subscribers were a geographically diverse lot of millionaires and wine buffs, mostly confined to the small group of wine collectors who were comfortable with econometric techniques. The newsletter's subscription base was just a fraction of the 30,000 people who plunked down $30 a year for Robert Parker's newsletter, The Wine Advocate. Ashenfelter's ideas reached a much larger audience in early 1990 when the New York Times published a front-page article about his new prediction machine. Orly openly criticized Parker's assessment of the 1986 Bordeaux. Parker had rated the 86s as very good and sometimes exceptional. Ashenfelter disagreed. He felt that the below-average growing season temperature and the above-average harvest rainfall doomed this vintage to mediocrity. Yet the real bombshell in the article concerned Orly's prediction about the 1989 Bordeaux. While these wines were barely 3 months in the cask and had yet to even be tasted by critics, Orly predicted that they would be the wine of the century. He guaranteed that they would be stunningly good. On his scale, if the great 1961 Bordeaux were 100, then the 1989 Bordeaux were a whopping 149. Orly brazenly predicted that they would sell for as high a price as any wine made in the last 35 years. The wine critics were incensed. Parker now characterized Ashenfelter's quantitative estimates as ludicrous and absurd. Sokolin said the reaction was a mixture of fury and fear. "He's really upset a lot of people." Within a few years, Wine Spectator refused to publish any more ads for his or any other newsletter. The traditional experts circled the wagons and tried to discredit both Orly and his methodology. His methodology was flawed, they said, because it couldn't predict the exact future price. For example, Thomas Matthews, the tasting director of Wine Spectator, complained that Ashenfelter's price predictions were exactly true only 3 times in the 27 vintages. Even though Orley's formula was specifically designed to fit price data, his predicted prices are both under and over the actual prices. However,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.